monitor the geographically differentiated crop yield effects from climate change. So we can look at the long-term scenarios at this very detailed level of what happens to yield of all the major crops. Those kinds of yield changes are then fed into our economic model, the agriculture sector. That's the impact model that's been developed at IFPRI. And from that, we can take these biophysical impacts from climate change and get estimates of food supply and demand, world food prices and trade, because the Philippines here is embedded in the global system, and food security and malnutrition impacts. We then also now, and I think this is important, is to look not just at the agriculture sector, but what happens in the broader economy due to economic climate change impacts in agriculture. This is very important because can give you reach beyond the Ministry of Agriculture to groups like the National Economic Development Authority, the finance ministries, which are much more interested in what are the broad impacts on the economy due to climate change, not just say what happens to rice or what happens to sugar. Just one sample, I think we had outside, are there briefs available? Where are they available?
Yes, they're available in our booth.
There's a booth outside that has briefs that give much more detail on results, but it's particularly important to note that, and here we focus on the economic impacts. We also have sort of great detail in the agriculture sector. But we find that by 2050, the average between 2010 and 2050 is an annual cost due to climate change of 186 billion Philippine pesos. That's about $3 billion per year due to climate change, including the human costs of malnutrition, about $41 billion, the $145 billion in these economy-wide losses. And this figure, this is average by 2050. The number is closer to $400 billion per year. So it's an accelerating cost to the economy due to climate change. Climate change reduces crop productivity growth, increases food prices, and therefore reduces food security. The negative impacts on the rest of the economy are driven both by increased commodity prices, which causes the terms of trade and real exchange rate losses and reduces growth in the industrial and service sectors and consumer welfare. So agriculture has powerful impacts beyond the agriculture sector. We then looked at what kinds of adaptation policies can help reduce those changes. And here we're basically modeling three different adaptation policies that increase rice productivity, increase area, and agriculture tariff reduction, reducing the taxes on imports and exports. We do it under two cases. The National Food Administration in the Philippines maintains various kinds of distorting policies to basically subsidize farmers and to reduce the openness of the economy to trade. So we look at the impact of these policies with and without the so-called NFA subsidy that distorts the rice sector. And you can see here, first thing to see is the very different impacts. So that by freeing up the economy from these NFA subsidies, you get much bigger impacts from the different adaptation policies. So for rice productivity, you get $128 million benefits for climate adaptation. Irrigated, 118 million Philippine pesos. Tariff reduction, 81 billion pesos. Much lower progress for climate change adaptation with those distortions in the economy. So you can see here the very important interaction between the agriculture sector and the rest of the economy and how they feed together. The other brief example I'm going to show is from new work we're doing, which uses the impact model and the general equilibrium model we talked about. This impact model, including the things such as the biophysical models and water resource models. Here, in this work, we've added a model on energy
that models the energy sector in great detail so that we can look at how the energy sector in this water, energy, food nexus work together in terms of trade-offs, synergies, and so forth. So we can look at policy and investments in energy sector, ag and non-ag again, so looking and then get outcomes not only, as I showed before, in the broad economy, agriculture, industry, and services, but also on food security and on changes in the energy sector, greenhouse gas emissions, and so forth. Let me just, again, very briefly, I won't go into details on this one, but this shows different energy scenarios for the Philippines. There's a reference scenario, these are all up to 2040. The reference scenario embeds various assumptions in the current Philippine energy plan. And as you can see, this shows the mix of energy supply from different sources. Red is coal, brownish yellow is gas, geothermal is the blue. That's a very important sector in the Philippines. And the green is the amount of energy supply for electricity in the Philippines from wind. Solar is a very small band in that. So you can see the reference plan in the Philippines is straightforward in saying this. Relies on coal, significant increases in the importation of coal to meet energy needs. That's because it is relatively low cost. Some of the other sources have been slowing down, domestic sources have been slowing down. As you can see, the result of that, it is a very heavy reliance on coal and therefore much higher greenhouse gas emissions. We then look at several different alternatives. One, it combines various policies to focus on CO2 mitigation. One is a straight carbon tax. Then we have various renewable target at the end and a so-called coal externality scenario that looks at various kinds of policies to reduce the impact of coal on greenhouse gas emissions in the environment. The thing to note is that each one of these does achieve significant improvement in reducing coal. And so from a climate change perspective, it does accomplish positive things. But we also see the yellow line is embedded in each of these curves. This is the additional cost in percentage terms, you can see on the right-hand side, compared to that reference scenario. So it does show the kind of trade-off. So to do these other ones, you do get additional costs to the Philippine economy anywhere from 5 to up to 20%. So it shows the kinds of decisions that have to be made by policymakers in terms of whether that kind of cost justifies the benefits in terms of reduced greenhouse gas emissions through coal. Some of the things we find here that, for example, the CO2 mitigation target scenario combines results in significant reductions in coal use and greenhouse gas emissions, 47% drop in imported fuel, which is mainly coal, and it has relatively low additional system costs, about 5%, so therefore could improve energy security and maintain a lower carbon approach. But again, at a cost relative to the current Philippine reference plan. So what are some conclusions here? We've got a couple slides here. Modeling is a very important tool to influence or strengthen the understanding of climate change and food security policies. It does look at the very systematically at trade-offs that occur as well as in win-win solutions. The integrated approach gives a more successful look in many cases at what the trade-offs are and can generate the kinds of outputs that can be used not only in agriculture but in other core sectors such as ministries of finance and energy. Downscaling global models to micro levels also helps to target results and policies below the national level. We do have regional results from this work, regional in the Philippines, I'm not showing here. And we're also attempting to build user-friendly models that we're in the process of transferring to Meta in the Philippines and to do for others. And then it's important once you have the outputs to target those outputs to the right stakeholders to enhance the policy impact. And it, I think one thing that most since quantitative analysts tend to forget about is that how do you, okay, you've got your nice report and you've shown the results, then what happens next? Briefly, I mean, some of the things you have to do is get the right boundary partners, who will actually take up and use these results, what influence do they have, and what do they need in order to make a difference. So, and that's what we've tried to do in the Philippines and elsewhere in the work we do. Partners have to be involved right from the start. Just bringing them in when you start cranking the model is not going to get buy-in. And again, it's very important to, as I've said a number of times, cut across the departmental silos of finance, agriculture, energy, and water, or you're often going to get lost in the mix. For each pathway, if this is something I think economists are bad at, probably I didn't do it perfectly well here either, but getting away from the economic jargon, trying to get to language that is more tenable for the stakeholders you're dealing with. Communications, that it needs to be a very important part in terms of, again, identifying how to convey the message, where and to whom. So, and finally, moving to advocacy coalitions. And IFPRI generally does not do direct advocacy, but works with partners who may be able to do that, in particularly in a given location. We don't like to come in and make strong advocacy in a place where we're not directly going to be affected by those decisions in a sense. So we show the sort of what if results from the modeling, but then need to look at what kind of coalitions, including environmental NGOs, government, downstream farmers and irrigation systems, how they can bring this use to a policymaking perspective. So thanks very much. That's really interesting.
Thank you, Dr. Rosen. But in the meantime, do you want to go next?
Yeah, so discussion at the end.
Yeah, we'll do discussion at the end, I feel.
Thanks, Emil, and thanks, Mark. I'm going to step back now from the country level and talk a little bit about modeling at the global level, which provides a context for the type of country level and also local scale analysis that are all part of the chain in moving from research to action. So I'm going to start with a slide, and I might have reconsidered this if I realized I was following immediately after my boss, but it's something that we like to keep in mind because it helps us think about what models are, how they're used, and what they're for. And this actually wasn't said specifically about the type of simulation modeling we're talking about today. These were a couple of statisticians who were talking about the types of models that they use, but it applies more generally. It makes us think about, a model is a deliberate simplification of reality for a particular purpose. And we discard some of the detail, but hopefully we keep the key features that are useful for the purpose that we have in hand. So some of you may have used a map before coming to Marrakesh or before coming to the GLF this morning to help get a sense of where it was, where you need to go, and hopefully that served the purpose. All of you who are here obviously made it. Likewise, in the type of modeling that we're talking about today, these simulation models that help us look far into the future. The landscape is much more complicated. The terrain itself is shifting underneath our feet as we look ahead 10, 20, 30 years, and climate change is just one of many important drivers that affect the results. So this is by way of a caution to say we're not using these models to predict the future or to say it's going to be this particular way in the year 2050. Rather, we're using them as tools to help us explore alternative pathways to get to different possible futures. So ultimately, there will be one future that will be realized when we get to 2030 or 2040 or 2050, but that depends on choices we make today. And so models are a tool that we can use to help explore different ways of getting to where we'd like to be as opposed to where we could end up without a particular kind of careful reflection on different options. Mark has already talked about some of the features that make models useful, so I'll just say briefly. Transparency, that's a challenge for us because these models are complicated. But that doesn't mean that they can't be transparent in terms of being clear about the assumptions that we make and the relationships that we're assuming between different variables and drivers that affect the outcomes that we're interested in. They have to be credible, which means they have to be built on reasonable assumptions, on reasonable relationships between, say, changes in income and changes in what we choose to eat, or changes in technology and how much is produced of particular commodities. And critically, they need to be flexible, because, as I said, the goal is not to produce a specific answer, but to look at how that answer depends on different choices that we make. And for that engagement with those who will use results from the model to make decisions and those who will be affected by those results is critical. Impact is the name of a modeling system that we use. I'll talk about that very briefly. We'll look a little bit about at some of the impacts of climate change on agriculture and the food system, and briefly on what that means for thinking about policy. So this is actually a system of models that we use with our partners throughout the CGIAR and elsewhere to look at alternative possible futures. It links models of climate change, of water, of crop growth with economic models to explore different relationships between them at different scales. But the analysis that I'll talk about today is primarily at the global and the regional scale. So here's one example. Making an assumption about how rapidly greenhouse gas emissions will increase, what that means for changes in temperature and precipitation. We can say under one particular scenario, this is the RCP 8.5, so a rapid climate change scenario, and one particular climate model from the Hadley Center in the UK, it implies certain patterns of temperature and precipitation in the year 2050. So that's the starting point. Those are inputs then into crop models. And in this case, this is the example of rain-fed maize yields around the world. And you can see, although you may not be able to read the legend, quite significant impacts on yields in different parts of the world. But that's just part of the story. These aren't the final yields that we'll expect. These are, in effect, what we would expect if we imposed a future climate on today's production systems. But we know that's going to trigger a whole series of changes. If yields actually fell that far, prices would rise. That means we as consumers would change what we eat to some degree. It means producers would also change how they produce and perhaps even what they choose to produce. So that's another step. But we continue on, and that's where the economic model comes in to look at some of those adaptations and market responses, which allows us ultimately to say, here's a range of possible outcomes for different assumptions about climate change as well as other variables in different parts of the world. So this is just one example, one particular set of assumptions that shows the pathway that we use in this type of model. Stepping back a bit, this summarizes a broader analysis that included not only the IFPRI impact model, but other modeling groups around the world at Wageningen and YASA and so forth. For a series of major crops, coarse grains, rice, wheat, oilseeds, and sugar, under different socioeconomic and climate change scenarios. So you may be familiar with these terms here, the shared socioeconomic pathways, SSP 1, 2, and 3, embodying different assumptions about how rapidly population changes, how rapidly incomes grow, and the different RCPs. But basically, what we see, I don't know if the pointer works here. Not surprisingly, yields decline, not so much as we sometimes see because there are these economic adjustments that help to mitigate those effects. But what is perhaps more surprising sometimes is to look at the center column there, production. Very little change actually in total production projected under any of these three scenarios. And it's important to note this is not relative to today's levels, but relative to levels in 2050 in the absence of climate change. So production is going to grow and significantly between now and 2050. But in terms of aggregate levels, we actually project that climate change won't have a large impact on the total, but rather a very significant impact on where this is produced and how it's produced, what it will cost to produce, and what the prices will be as a result. So area increases here about 4 to 5%, depending on the scenario. That's actually about double the rate of land use or land use change that we project between now and 2050 as a result of climate change. So that's obviously going to have important implications for a variety of environmental indicators, whether it's water quality or biodiversity, greenhouse gas emissions, and so forth. Prices column there, about 15% increase under the most extreme case over there, which is the SSP3, a fragmented world with RCP 8.5, which is rapid climate change. And that 15%, again, it's about double the price increase that we would expect in the absence of climate change. So that's going to have important implications for food security, obviously. So I'll just jump to a couple sets of results here. Looking at hunger in 2030, which is the time frame for the SDGs. These bars on the left axis here show absolute numbers of people who are at risk of hunger under different scenarios. The blue shows basically where we are today, around 800 million people undernourished. The orange bar, the second one, shows that in the absence of climate change, because of income growth and so forth, we're projecting that the number of people at risk of hunger actually falls to about 500 million. But that's reversed. Some of those losses or some of those reductions are offset by climate change, which is shown in the third bar there. Nearly 100 million people more will be hungry in 2030 as a result of climate change than would have been otherwise. Fortunately, there are things that we can do about that. And the fourth bar here, the yellow one, shows the results of a scenario that includes various types of investment that improve production and efficiency in agriculture. And that includes agricultural research and development, new seed varieties, better tolerance to drought and heat, for example. That includes better management of resources, particularly soil and water. And it includes complementary investments in infrastructure to improve market access, both for inputs and outputs. And so the combination of those investments in this particular scenario allows us to bring that number of hungry people back down below the level that we would have achieved otherwise, either with or without climate change. Those are the bars on the left axis. The little circles represent on the right-hand axis the share of population with hunger. And we can see in all regions, with the exception of Africa south of the Sahara, that that proportion falls to about 5% or less. Africa lags a bit, and there are particular challenges there in terms of the need for R&D and these other types of investments that I was talking about. So these investments, that's one set of policy options that we need to consider, and here's one example of the potential impacts that those could have. Another set of policy options is on the demand side, the consumption side. And these are results just as an example of recent research that we've done with colleagues at Oxford University, looking at what would be the possible impacts of pricing food according to the role that they play in increasing greenhouse gas emissions as they are produced. Won't go into detail on this, but just to show on the top map there, one of the reasons this is a sensitive topic is because it has the potential to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, but taxing food is obviously a very sensitive topic because the poor spend disproportionately high amounts on food. And in the map on the top right, you can see there that if we taxed foods according to their contribution to greenhouse gas emissions, that would have adverse impacts, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia. So that's clearly a concern. But you can adjust and do a different scenario that says, well, let's not tax all foods based strictly on their contribution to greenhouse gas emissions. Let's, for example, we could exempt those foods that are particularly important for the poor. We could use the revenue from those types of taxes to subsidize certain types of food, such as, in this case, fruit and vegetables. And doing different scenarios like that, in this case, allows us to find one where those adverse impacts on health are minimized, and in fact, we get positive impacts on health as well as reductions in greenhouse gas emissions from a policy approach like this. So this is just to show, again, by the way, that there are ways to explore alternative policy scenarios to look at different ways of balancing trade-offs in this very complicated area. So to wrap up, some of these echo things that Mark said in his presentation, we see increases in the pressure on natural resources and slowing progress and reducing hunger under different scenarios, but it's important to explore those and see how sensitive different types of indicators are to different potential policy responses, impacts on diet and health as well. But the result being that a mix of policies and investments that are targeted to critical areas, critical populations, and that recognize the trade-offs between different types of goals that we're looking for are critical. And in terms of making these kinds of results useful for policymakers, again, our analysis at this global scale, global and regional, tends to be supported by and to inform partners such as international donors and our partners in the global research community. But reaching national and subnational decision makers, as an example that Mark presented and that Alex will talk a little about in a moment, requires linking to other types of tools. We can't look for all of the answers in this global scale analysis, but this is part of the context that helps inform the picture. And finally, that we need to build the links for that type of analysis and that type of engagement into our planning, both on the research side and also on the policy side, so that we can have this type of iteration and explore alternative scenarios as opposed to just publishing a set of results that are interpreted as predictions and expecting that is going to be sufficient. So with that, thanks very much, and I'll hand it over to Alex.
Okay, good morning. Thank you for coming to this session. So you have seen from my colleagues some examples of user modeling. This is what we do a lot at IFPRI. What I wanted to do in my presentation is actually offer some considerations, some thoughts about how a certain type of research, the policy-oriented research, is evolving now. And also drawing from some recent experience in terms of our work, how we can improve the collaboration among researchers and policymakers. So have you seen that, you know, a lot of this stuff that we do should be of particular interest and use for policymakers and stakeholders. The thing is that the relationship between the research community and policymakers can improve and should improve. So, of course, we have moved a long way from when, you know, the research was happening in the ivory tower. And so that doesn't happen so much anymore. However, it is clear that there is still a need for a better interaction between the research community and researchers and policymakers. And in fact, you know, there is a growing call for scientists to provide more usable research, and also a call for funds to be allocated to projects that actually have that sort of goal as one of the output of the project, and sort of informing policymakers. There is also an increased recognition of the importance of a close collaboration among scientists and users and stakeholders. And this is particularly true for issues related to climate change, which is particularly complicated, and there's a lot of information, and sometimes the information is contradictory, and it's hard to make sense out of it, and the research community can really help with that. And of course, you know, as policymakers and researchers become more engaged, there has to be a better understanding of the various needs and a better understanding of how to collaborate and also how to share resources and then how to provide the data. However, if you look around, there is a growing number of successful collaboration, which is really important. But I think that the point that I'm trying to make is still not enough, and we can improve on that. I was here last year talking about a recent work, research, that we had done with the government of Colombia and that had informed their INDC. I was particularly happy because it was particularly successful. It doesn't happen very often when your research really gets included in an official document. And in particular, what appeared useful is this sort of global to local approach in which these exogenous forces are need to be taken into consideration when you have to devise long-term policies like the ones that have to deal with climate change. But then those national plans also have repercussions for local communities, and those local communities and their needs and preferences then sort of determine what is actually feasible. And then ultimately that feeds back into the global sort of community in terms of how a country can contribute, for instance, to reduction of emissions, greenhouse gas emissions. And I was here talking about this work, and you know, it was particularly interesting because it was connecting multiple scales, and the work that Keith and Mark were describing is part of that. It's this idea of sort of moving from the global to the national, to the local, and we have developed these tools. But however, at this point, a year later, I see that there is even more work that needs to be done. And part of this is that, you know, cool things and cool findings are fantastic, but unfortunately is not enough to really have an impact. So I've tried to represent here sort of an old fashion of doing research. And some people would say that this is a straw man, it doesn't really happen like this, this is a linear way. But I would say that actually, too often, it gets too close to this model. And so you have the research institution of the researcher that initially has some contact with stakeholders, with the donors, gets the data, and then goes back in the office and does the work and then provides the results to the end users or the funding agency. And there are good reasons for this to happen, actually, I think. First of all, researchers are often not the most socially oriented people, and so we tend to work in our office and feel perfectly comfortable with that. But also, if you think in terms of what are the career sort of rewards for researchers, it's, you know, the number of published articles, and this is a very efficient way of publishing peer-reviewed work. So I can tell you that this happens a little too often. However, what we know, and there's literature now on this, research, on projects, that tells us that, you know, the co-production of knowledge is actually extremely helpful. It is shown that it generates information that better supports management decisions. And then not only it facilitates the sort of the use of the research results by the end users and by the stakeholders, but also through that co-production of knowledge, okay, it fosters some creative solutions across sort of the researchers themselves. So you might sort of think about new questions that you hadn't thought at the very beginning. This is through this sort of engagement with the brand. End users. And so building on that sort of project and work that I was telling you about, sort of the work in Colombia on the INDC, we wrote an article with my collaborators in Colombia. We wrote an article that was looking at the process that we followed in Colombia to have such a heavy impact. And we try to understand what is that we had done, not on purpose, not fully on purpose, but what is that had done and had contributed to the success. And so here I've tried to sort of draw sort of the kind of relationships that actually sort of came together to, as I said, to have a successful sort of use of our research. And as you can tell, it's very different. But this sort of, now hopefully it makes some sense to you, but it tries to represent about a two-year collaboration and a constant interaction between researchers and stakeholders at all sorts of different levels. And so you have the research institution that collaborates and continuously is in contact with stakeholders in terms of exchanging data, data in terms of a changing research question and informing in which direction and what numbers and what particular insights would be useful for them. All this would actually happen through what we call a boundary organization, which is sort of a trusted broker. In that case, was the CGIAR program on climate change that has a very strong presence and a strong collaboration with the end user, which in that case, in the case of Colombia, was the Ministry of the Environment. So, but what is important here in this sort of circular motion that this diagram is trying to convey is this continuous interaction. This is 2 years of work that was building another 2 years of research. So a long time to actually get it done. So I'm going to just go over some few takeaway lessons from our experience. And so this is stuff that you actually see in the published literature, this idea that you have to have sustained stakeholder interaction, continuous. Okay, and you have to be able to talk to them. As Mark and Keith have mentioned already, the transparency and openness of the engagement process is essential to be inclusive, to make sure that all stakeholders at one point have a voice. They have to buy into the process. And the transparency in the modeling part, and the capability of actually including new data when that data comes sort of becomes available. And then this is incredibly taxing, but important is the willingness and the capacity to break through disciplinary and institutional barriers, which is very difficult. You have to develop this common language across the people involved. But also, what we found that in our case was extremely important was this idea of having a local institution that was acting as a champion for the project. In this case, was the ministry, part of the ministry itself, but it continuously supported us. It supported the idea of the importance of including more research and more knowledge into, in this case, the INDC document of the country. And that was really the deal breaker. And also, for the donors, this idea that there has to be a greater flexibility in the use of funds. Because sometimes you start with some clear ideas of how you're going to spend the money on your project, but it doesn't end up in that way. And you have to be able to shift things around as this interaction with stakeholders develops. And also, how you assess the project. Okay, everybody wants to have impact, but in the meantime, you have to understand exactly how the impact can be measured. And then finally, since I'm also a modeler, I wanted to reiterate this idea that actually the importance in our case of the model was this idea that it really provided this objective basis for discussion across stakeholders who are part of different power structures. So there are people who are more powerful and better connected with the ministry than others. But at that point, you have something everybody sort of can start from. And that also was incredibly powerful in our case. So to conclude, as I said, we have new modeling tools. We can develop all sorts of new insights. But what is really useful? What is useful for the community that then ultimately will have to implement project, will have to use this data, and make decisions that try to go beyond those structure of power that I was talking about. And what kind of information do policymakers really need to implement their plans? And what information can facilitate the dialogue among the implementers and those who then ultimately have to live with the outcomes of those decisions?
Dr. Sambia, would you like to join us?
Thank you. Good morning to everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting the Philippine National Economic and Development Authority for this important part. It's a way by which we could really stress how important the linkage with research institutions is. You know, for institutions like us, development planning and policy formulation, project evaluation, policy prioritization, and all those things, it's important how results of research like this, you know, would really help us in our policy formulation and development, developing our you know, upcoming Philippine Development Plan for 2017-2022. So Mark already provided you with, you know, the impact model, how to describe how the model was, you know, the structure of the model and the things that it can do. And so just a little background on how we were able to, you know, get engaged, the NEDA in particular got engaged with IFP, is that, you know, then our secretary, Arsenio Balisacan, was, you know, the secretary of the National Economic Development Authority, really wanted to get, to have, you know, a tool by which, you know, we could simulate scenarios, we could come up with some magnitudes of, you know, numbers that could really influence, that could really, you know, provide some, you know, understanding to our policymakers on how, you know, problems like, you know, for some measures or how we should really respond to problems, you know, would be very, very beneficial to economic development, to reaching the development targets that we want for the Philippines. So, you know, he was talking to me then, and I knew impact from when I was, you know, also involved there in the institution. So I told him that, let's start with, you know, Mark Rosegrant, because, you know, I think impact would be able to, you know, do exactly what you want. And so what was already discussed a while ago, asking the right question, knowing what you want to do, knowing what you want the model would like you to inform about, was exactly really the things that, you know, that really make things, the interaction work, you know, between model research institutions and government agencies. So when Mark came over to the Philippines, we discussed about it. And so that's where, you know, it all started. And we were very much concerned about climate change, you know, how vulnerable the Philippines is. Everybody probably still remembers that big typhoon, that super typhoon Haiyan that inflicted a lot of, you know, destructions in the Visayas Islands. And that's not the end of it. Just last October, we had another close to a super typhoon 5 that really devastated, you know, the rice farms in the northern part of the Philippines. And it's not only typhoons, even the El Nino, which we had, you know, very severe one, just the first semester of 2016. It dried up a lot of, like, corn farms in Mindanao, you know, bringing corn farmers really too close to really poverty and difficulty of really, you know, getting you know, themselves back again to, you know, to do their livelihood activities. So so we did impact, okay, and the results indeed, you know, Mark has already shown to you those numbers, and it was really very much appreciated. You know, there are estimates, right? You know, but then that already gives sorts of an idea to policymakers, to different stakeholders, and what it could really mean if we are not going to be doing something, okay? So the scenarios that provided us with the different adaptation measures, especially for agriculture, was really something that was very much appreciated by, you know, our senators. Senator Villar, who is the head of the Committee on Agriculture in our Senate, you know, was our speaker, and I was in one of the policy forum, and she really expressed that, you know, studies like this are things that they would need to aid them in their legislative work. So, you know, they need the numbers, you know, even though they're estimates, they need those numbers to really, you know, provide, you know, evidence that, you know, indeed, if you don't do anything, you know, we'll probably get into something worse than what we are now. And We had also some policy briefs that we were able to distribute. And those policy briefs, you know, got into Congress, got into Senate, and now the office of Senator LaGuardia, who is championing climate change in our country, are using those alternative scenarios, adaptation scenarios that was given there, to inform even our Department of Agriculture that, look, there are indeed adaptation measures that you could really get into to help you, you know, get that sector really resilient against climate change. It's just a matter of really trying to determine which one would work and which one would not work. So, but there are alternatives, are you? The most, I think, and this has been hard work, difficult work that we have been doing in the past. There has been several studies with regards to the rice trade policy of the Philippines. Okay, the NFA subsidy that Mark showed, and lifting our QRs. The results probably came at the right time when we have this new administration, wherein they were also critical on those. So in one of the cabinet meeting that we had, it's a meeting among the economic managers. And the economic managers are composed of the Secretary of Finance, the Secretary of the National Economic and Development Authority, the Secretary of the Department of Trade and Industry, the Secretary of Department of Budget and Management, and we invited the Department of Agriculture. They wanted to really assess, you know, whether extending the QR is going to be still the policy for that we need to continue. Subsidizing NFA would be still the policy. And the results that we had, under this project really validated the past results that we have already had. And so it strengthened the decision among the economic managers to really, to say that really lifting the QR is the best way to go. And restructuring NFA so that it just becomes, you know, buffer stacking, you know, maintaining the buffer stack would be the only way to go. And so just before I left, I came up with a memorandum of circular or memorandum order, some kind of instruction to be considered by the president to really start the process of, you know, tariffication, you know, liberalizing rice, okay? So that will go to the office of the president, and because we really need to do a lot of things to be able to liberalize the rice market. One, we have an Agricultural Tariffication Act, and rice is exempted from there. So we really need to amend that law so that rice should be included also as one of those crops that we've done. So there are several things that, you know, that processes that we need to do in order to be able to get into, you know, a better rice market policy. So we are now in the process of formulating our Philippine Development Plan, and I think a lot of the recommendations that we had in this project, particularly on strengthening the resiliency of agriculture, will be, you know, very, very will be valuable inputs to our work. We are also in the process of updating our Agricultural and Fisheries Modernization Act, and again, those adaptive measures will go as really very valuable inputs there. Our Department of Budget and Management, even without the, you know, they already asked for the studies, because, you know, they were as references, they do the evaluation, they do the prioritization of projects primarily for agriculture. That would be a very valuable resource or for a reference material for them to be able to, you know, do all these things. And with the results, also we hope that we will be able to influence the Department of Agriculture to reallocate more, you know, a greater part of its budget, you know, outside rice to high value crops, which is, you know, what we think would be, you know, a measure by which we could really increase the incomes of farmers, and also to, you know, afford more funds to activities like research and development and extension. So the energy simulation that, you know, came out, this is also the first time that I saw that simulation. I think those are going to be very valuable also, because we are now, you know, sort in a dilemma on how we would really position our energy plan to go really, you know, to shift away from coal-based to really low carbon. And, you know, there has been, like, you know, issues with regards to how can we, you know, get that target of industrializing if we really go to this. So it's really going to be, you know, this will probably provide us some information on how we would really proceed balancing, you know, that low emission-based energy policy with regards to, you know, the coal-based or the fuel-based policy. And so again, you know, I think really linking more to research institutions that would provide us with the valuable inputs to our policy work, to our development, formulation of our development plans, is now increasingly being recognized as really very much needed in the Philippines, and I think that's also the same in other countries. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm Carol Saint-Laurent from IUCN, the International Union for Conservation of Nature, and I'll just mention I'm French-Canadian, have a tendency to gesticulate wildly as I speak, so if the microphone ends up over here, someone please signal me, I'll bring it back. So for those of you who may not know IUCN very well, I'll just mention really quickly that we're a union of members, of state and non-state members. We have about 1,300 members, and we also have expert commissions with more than 16,000 experts. That allows us to work from the local to the global level. It allows us to work on an issue right from having the idea to generating knowledge, to influencing policy, to implementing the action on the ground through our members, which is kind of a special situation to be in. I'd like to thank our host today, IPFRI, for including IUCN in this event, and we look forward to strengthening our collaboration with you. I work primarily on the international policy side of things, and so I was expecting actually to come into this event with sort of a different perspective, but I was struck by how aligned our thinking is after listening to these presentations. Things like I was going to start with general comments about, you know, science policy influence is not a linear process. We heard that already. We need more than communication of research findings in order to achieve impacts. We've heard that. So it's an ongoing process also. It's not just you take one step, leads you to another one, and then you've got your wonderful impact. It's a loop all the time at the ongoing policy process. Even if you've got fantastic findings, as people are thinking through how to implement those findings, additional challenges will come up. And this point about continuous engagement being critical was brought up by a couple of speakers. What I'd like to do is just illustrate this a bit with a couple of examples from IUCN's work, how we're addressing science policy linkages at different levels. First of all, at the global level, and this will be linked to our work mostly on forest landscape restoration. And I'll just mention very quickly, by that we mean restoration of degraded lands, deforested lands at a landscape scale. It's about restoring forward to meet the needs of societies in the future, not looking back to some ideal historical state. It's about building multifunctional landscapes, which is where this ties in very well with addressing food security, really at this landscape scale. So at the global level, we had this knowledge product that we came up with in 2011, a World of Opportunities map. And this showed that around the world, and it was based on globally consistent data, so obviously not the finest data available, but it did show us, told us that around the world, there were more than 2 billion hectares where restoration opportunities may be found. So at the time of doing this analysis, there were other things going on. So we had, just before that, the Aichi targets being adopted under the CBD, the emergence and strengthening of the PLUS in Red Plus. We had the Rio Plus 20 event lead to the land degradation neutrality goal. putting that together gave a real boost to the global restoration movement, the knowledge and the international policy framework. And that triggered us, with Germany and others, to launch the Bond Challenge, which is a global effort to restore 150 million hectares by 2020 and 350 million hectares by 2030. And that's kind of taken off. We have 38 pledgers who, between them, have committed almost 125 million hectares so far. But we're seeing that showing up in policy arenas as well. For example, 114 countries in their climate change nationally determined contributions for the land sector included restoration of forest landscapes. And many countries are including restoration of forests in their biodiversity strategies and action plans. But so far, so good. But that's not the end of the job. And there are some really additional, very important audiences that we want to engage. And how do we do that? By adding an extra layer to the knowledge generation, to the analysis. So for example, we're doing some work on restoration opportunities in mangroves worldwide with the Nature Conservancy. We're doing work with a number of partners on the role of restoration of forest landscapes and ecosystem-based adaptation, disaster risk reduction. And we hope to be doing that work with the folks here today on food security and how that links up with forest landscape restoration. At the national and subnational level, we generated a methodology, the Restoration Opportunities Assessment methodology. And I'll just briefly touch on this example, where this has taken us, including a specific example of how this links to the policy process in Malawi. So we're applying this methodology in about 25 countries currently. And the idea is to generate new knowledge, including on the various benefits of restoration, including for food security, to help countries and subnational jurisdictions define restoration targets, define where appropriate restoration interventions might be possible. So within this, you've got things like stakeholder prioritization of restoration interventions, cost-benefit analysis of the different interventions, diagnostic of an assessment of key success factors, that sort of thing. And in the Malawi situation, I'll just explore that for a minute if you'll allow me to. So we piloted a Rome assessment at a district level at the start rather than national. And through that process, stakeholders identified priority areas, suitable restoration intervention types, key success factors, enabling conditions that were absolutely essential, costs and benefits, et cetera. In this case, food security was actually the driver for Malawi's interest in carrying out a restoration opportunities assessment. It wasn't just another layer that was being factored in. It was very firmly the entry point. And this involved then generating information about food availability, food accessibility, food utilization. So based on the outcomes of this district-level assessment, the Department of Forestry pledged to do an assessment for the whole country, again driven by the food security issue. And this kicked off in February of this year and involved different government departments, academia, civil society, media, district authorities. And I think this aspect of involving all of these different sectors in the knowledge generation and policy development process is absolutely essential. So they will be looking at the current situation in terms of crop production, poverty, drivers of food insecurity, and how FLR interventions, restoration interventions defined, identified by the stakeholders, could enhance crop production and make communities more resilient to climate change. What it would cost and how it would benefit the average household. One contributing factor to helping to move this work forward towards impact in Malawi was that the director of the Forest Department, Dr. Clement Chilima, became a real champion, a leading advocate for the knowledge generation and policy change process. And even the preliminary findings that were obtained enabled Malawi to set some restoration targets. And so during the IUCN Congress in Hawaii in September, they announced that they would restore 2 million hectares by 2020 and an additional 2.5 million hectares by 2030 for a total of 4.5 million hectares. So, you know, what are some of the lessons that we can draw from this and other examples? As we've heard, I think it's absolutely essential to embed the knowledge generation process in existing institutions and policy processes. right from the start. So the key agents of change are involved right from the beginning. It's important to identify people who can be champions. Champions for not just for the outcomes once the research is done, but champions for the whole process of starting to define what that research work will be. Public awareness is a bonus factor. In Malawi, there's a plant one tree per person per year policy and campaign, which helps to create the conditions within which the research can have more impact. So really, to tailor research and policy development also to these national priorities is, I mean, it's evident, isn't it? But it's the absolutely critical starting point for all of this. For Malawi, it was food security. In other places, it's different. For China, we've worked on water security for mega cities. That's their entry point for the research they want to see done and the policy impacts they want to see delivered. Adaptation-based mitigation to reduce flooding in El Salvador. And in the United States, recovery from wildfire and the creation of jobs, which may actually be a really useful thing in the years to come. So just in conclusion, just to close off, as a summary, you know, that the effective deployment of new knowledge and insights plugged into policy-making processes that respond directly to the national priorities, supported by champions in key positions, this is essential for scaling up to healthy, productive, multifunctional landscapes. And we look forward to reinforcing our collaboration with partners here today and others to making this happen in landscapes around the world. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to invite all presenters to the front and we'll open it up for questions. Yes, actually.